Good evening, everybody. I welcome you all today. We are back to our online session, World's Party Baat, and this is your host, Archana Malhotra. Today, we have with us a leader who's taken SBI cards to new heights. And in the past 2 years, under his leadership, the company introduced new areas of data analytics, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and robotic process automation, which are now the hallmark of SBI cards. Over the years, he held multiple leadership positions at SBI, including Chief General Manager, LHO Hyderabad, Mumbai, Bareilly Module, Lucknow, and Vice President, Trade and Systems, SBI Los Angeles, among others. He holds a master's degree in chemistry. An avid reader, his other interests include music, traveling, and photography. Let us all welcome Mr. Hardayal Prasad, the MD and CEO of SBI Cards. Welcome, Mr. Prasad.
Thank you very much, Archana. It's a pleasure to be here.
Pleasure to have you here. So, I'm going to start right away. After a long and successful partnership of 19 years, GE Capital decided to exit their joint venture with SBI Cards. This was in line with GE's strategy to exit financial business worldwide. In December 2017, SBI and the Carlyle Group acquired GE Capital's entire stake. So SBI Cards treated this as an opportunity and rolled out Project Catalyst to develop new systems, processes, and frameworks. What was your role then?
Okay, I think it's a long story, but obviously, I think 1998, State Bank of India did not have the wherewithal for issuance of credit card, and they were not. There were very few credit card players, and State Bank of India was not there, and that is why the GE relationship started. Because I think the GE had a very close relationship with DLF, and that is why one of the reasons that this is the only subsidiary of State Bank of India, which is set up in Gurgaon. For almost 19 years, this relationship continued. So the two outfits were created. One of them was a front end, which was actually controlled by State Bank of India, and the back end was controlled by where the technology was brought in by the GE, and they continued to hold the majority shareholding in the back end company. Now this obviously continued, and the company had a seesaw. It went up its highs and lows, especially the GFC, the global financial crisis that it went through. So it actually came out of it in 2010. And since 2010, October, it has never actually incurred a loss. It has always been. However, as because the GE was exiting the financial industry across the globe, this was among the last company that they exited. And once they exited, I mean, there was a big process through which a lot of people came forward to acquire a stake of GE. Finally, Carlyle, which is, I think, among the largest PE company in the world, they acquired some of the shares from GE, and the remaining were taken by SBI. Now, at that stage, what was happening was that most of the technology that was being provided to SBI Card was a generic kind of legacy kind of architecture that was built in. Across the globe, they would have control over the either the core banking operations, the fraud control, the AML part of it, the email part thing, the logins part, and there was massive amount of transaction monitoring that was happening across the globe. Somewhere from Africa, GE would manage it. The email server were in Europe. The core application was running in Australia. So it was a very distributed architecture that was there. And actually at that stage, we had 18 months with GE to actually, we had a transition sales agreement to get out of the GE. We took exactly, 14 months to get out of it. And that was the time, and I joined simultaneously. I joined 2 days prior to the signing of the agreement between SBI and Carlyle. And I think that was an opportunity to actually come in with an absolutely new architecture. And we built a new IT stack, which was completely inside. We now also hold the proprietary, the intellectual properties of all these software that we built, the applications that we built, and we introduced new age technologies. But today, I think we are a data company. I mean, anything that we do is the data. The huge data, we had almost about 2 petabytes of data that we brought from Australia. I think one of the first projects to bring the core applications before the Reserve Bank of India came out with the instructions on data localization. We brought everything from Australia over here. I think that was one of the opportunities to bring in new technologies. We are heavily in RPAs. We have at any given point of time in about 50 to 70 process automations going in. We have artificial intelligence running in our transaction monitoring, on our fraud monitoring, on our risk models. If you actually look at across the organization, it is highly, I would say that it is a data company. It just issues cards. It's not actually a card issuing company. It's more of a data company.
So in the last 2 years, under your leadership, the turnover of SBI has shot up from 7,800 to 70,000 crores, which is a tremendous jump. And I was reading somewhere that had it not been for COVID-19, you would have crossed the 100,000 crores mark. So can you please explain how, what was the journey, how you managed that?
Actually, when it's signed, now that everybody knows about it, was quite a privy information. But on the 15th of December 2017, when GE exited, the company was valued at 7,800. And that's the value at which Carlyle came in. And when the journey started, one was actually to rebuild the company on the IT stack, on the processes, on the systems and everything that was required. The second was that it was also decided that you're going to have an IPO coming up shortly. So there are a few things that we did. One is I mentioned to you on the on exit from the GE. The second thing was to merge the two companies, because with the same shareholding of Carlyle and SBI, it didn't make sense to have two companies. So we merged both the companies, and then the IPO process started. In this whole process, we traveled across the globe, because we wanted credit card. There are not more than about 15, 20 large companies in the world. And it was important anywhere that I would go, not many people would know what credit card industry is. And how it, everybody knows credit card, but they don't know how a credit card company works. I think there was a lot of amount of sensitization that took place in about 1.5 years. And that is the story at which we started. Once you have built a story and you come back and you make changes or process changes or whatever changes are required, it is at that stage that you approach the merchant bankers and you ask them that what exactly would be a valuation. SBI credit card doesn't even have a benchmark. I mean, the closest they would talk is about Bajaj, but we said it cannot be, the model is different. Our model is based on revenue streams which are different. Our model is based on revenue streams that come from interest and the fee income. The Bajaj and any other company, if you look at it, their model is actually primarily only interest. The income is coming primarily from the interest element. So we had to actually talk to the merchant bankers, explain to them whether it is going to be a price to earning model or it's going to be a price to book model. And then finally, with a lot of amount of back and forth, it was finally decided that we are going to have a price earning model, because the earnings are different. And based on the merchant bankers' advice, it was decided that actually the company is in multiples, the 21, because we're coming in the first quarter, last quarter of 20. Based on the 21, we said they felt that it has to be about approximately 32 to 35 times the multiples of the 21 profit. I think that's the way the valuation arrived at. So there's a lot of hard work, persistence, data, new age technologies. If you really look at it, it's been a magical story. Not many companies would increase from 7,000 to about 70.
Yeah, it has been a magical jump, and it shows that so much of perseverance, teamwork, and automation, everything has gone into it. So coming to now, about the 500 crore big SBI card IPO launch in the beginning of March. So the issue was oversubscribed by 26.22 times on the final day, in spite of COVID-19 already hitting us. So can you please explain the entire journey of how it happened, and more so towards the end stages where you actually launched it?
Actually, the IPO had two elements. One was an offer for sale, in which 10% was actually diluted by Carlyle and 4% was diluted by SBI. Now, that was a big issue. And 500 crore is only what we wanted for our capital purposes. So the total issue size was almost 10,300 crore. This is the third largest issue in India ever. And after 2011, this has been the largest issue. So nowhere, it was massive issue. There was no second thought about that. The only thing was that we wanted to hit the street somewhere in January, but because of some issues in the group companies of SBI, it got stuck. And there were some, you know, the SEBI has its own norms of taking a certain amount of time when there are some actions against one of the companies of within the group. And that is why it got postponed. I wish if it would have come in January, obviously we would not only have, you know, breached this 26 times also. We may have hit the 100,000 mark very quickly. But as we move forward, the premium in the gray market went up to almost about 370%, or 370 rupees. And 755 was the issue price. So it was expected that it would open almost about 1,000 rupees, somewhere around that range. And within a span of 1 week, I mean, I traveled almost everywhere in India and abroad. Within a span of 7-10 days, the gray market premium came down from 370 rupees to maybe hardly about 50 to 70 rupees. I think it's been, if you personally look at it, it's quite a setback for us. But if we would have delayed it for another 5 days, probably we might have to pull back the IPO because it would not have made sense for not getting it subscribed. So it's been quite a journey in terms of that.
So now the prices have fallen by over 20%?
Almost 25%.
About 25%, and the dream run has ended actually, and lockdown is in full swing. The future is on a shaky footing. What is going to be the status in the oncoming months, as per you? Of course, nobody knows for sure, but as per you,
a couple of things. We don't look at the share price. I look at it every day, but that doesn't mean that we get influenced by the share price, and especially when the bourses are behaving not because of the fundamentals of a company, or because of the way the profitability is going to evolve. Actually, it is more to do with the nature's forces, and there's nothing much that can be done at this stage. I don't think that our business model is flawed. We have any issue in terms of our profitability, in terms of what we are doing it, in terms of the way we actually assess a customer or a client or a cardholder. The model is absolutely fantastic, and we are the only pure play credit card company in India. All credit card companies in India are sitting within the bank. We are the only one. I don't want to compare American Express, because American Express has a license as a bank in India. They don't have a license for issuing a credit card only. We are the only company which has it. So the business model is absolutely amazing. It's just a matter of time. I think the last report, just 2 days back, if you look at the Bank of America report, it's giving a target price of almost about 680 in the next about 6 months. It just goes on to prove that obviously the profitability is good. We have strong systems procedures in place. The risk models are fantastic. We have machine learning that runs it. We have external and internal and external scoring that we do. So I think it's just a matter of time that we will bounce back. And I'm sure that if any one of you have the shares, you're going to make huge money out of it.
So just tell me I'll go to the questions of all our friends. But first, I want to ask you, what according to you, how is the market going to behave in the current scenario and in the near future? I mean, I know it's going topsy-turvy. Some days, some go really, like banking sector is really down now. So what do you think is going to be the status in the current month or so? At least.
Very difficult. It's a very difficult question. I do not have an answer for that, that how it is going to behave. It's going to depend on the gravity and the extent of the COVID that is going to take place. We have built our own scenarios. We do massive risk modeling that we do. We have built our scenarios based on the scenario. The base scenario that when every day it looks like that we are going to breach the base scenario. The base scenario was that we will have a business as usual somewhere in October. We had a mild kind of effect of it, which said that if it is medium, it's going to affect me in a medium way, then probably January or February is going to be the month. But I think we probably are going to see a rebound only next year. It's going to be very difficult to actually come out with social distancing. And there was a news item, I think yesterday I saw, that probably India might explode like US. Today, if you look at it, I think there is a news item about Ahmedabad also. So very difficult to say how the bosses are going to behave.
I know. For everybody, it's all wait and watch. Keep your fingers crossed and hope for the best. So we move on to our friends' questions. Rajiv Budhiraja is saying, what is the share on non-cash payments in India? And how quickly is India progressing in terms of reducing cash in the economy?
Okay. Actually, I'll take you back to 2016 when the demonetization took place. And it was almost 92% was the cash transaction. Only 8% were digital transaction. But the demonetization obviously brought in massive amount of opportunities to a lot of people. And the overall cash came down from almost about 92%. It came down to almost about 73%. Never ever actually we were able to come down significantly. However, it actually provided massive amount of opportunities and financial inclusion to a lot of people. So it is not just that the cash came down, but the digital penetration improved significantly. And because of the demonetization, if you really look at the infrastructure of the POS, that improved phenomenally from almost about 3-4 lakh terminals that were there. 3 million, I think, at that time, I think about 1.5 million terminals. We are almost at about 3 to 4 million from terminals. That is massive infrastructure that has been created. And then you have these, you know, online players that came and started doing well. And the most important thing has happened, those apps kind of. You know, never ever I could have imagined that if I was traveling in a car or a taxi, I would pay by a card. I mean, we paid by card, it's becoming sub-ubiquitous. I mean, the food used to come to our houses long time since long. Were we paying it? We were always paying cash. And today you imagine that, you know, there is an app, it's not a POS machine, it's an app, and you just pay it. So I think what has happened is that the digital payments in a card industry, we have moved to a level which is almost about 40%. 40% of our total transaction. And every day we were doing pre-COVID, we were doing almost about 1.4 million transactions per day. And out of that, on any given day, you would have almost about 40% of the transactions coming only through the digital mode, not through the, I would say everything is digital for me. Even if it is coming from a POS terminal, it is digital. But I'm saying that the electronic transaction, what you look at the e-commerce and all those transactions. And on a peak level, when you have those, you know, a billion rupee sale kind of stuff, the big bazaars, the Amazon sales, it goes up to almost about 60%. So there is significant penetration that has taken place in terms of the digital. And I think it's pretty good what we see. I think we were quite upbeat in terms of the conversion that was taking place.
So Anurag Malhotra is asking, artificial intelligence is assisting in SBI in which all pieces of your business, SBI cards?
So there is hardly anything that is not happening on the artificial intelligence. When we actually source application, and if any one of you has undergone it, we give you an in-principle approval in 10 seconds. And we have almost about 33,000 kiosks sitting in India. This is only on the open market size. On the banca, we service almost about 15 to 17,000 branches out of 23,000 branches of SBI. So when actually we do a quick data entry for you, in 10 seconds, we tell you that actually you have an in-principle approval or not. And in 10 seconds itself, we go to the CIBIL, the credit bureaus. We actually do a dedupe of our database. We actually run a complete our scoring engine and we tell you. And simultaneously, we are also checking your PAN number and we give you an in-principle approval. All this would not have been possible because at every level, and this is just, I'm telling you, customer facing, the transaction monitoring. In very, very nanoseconds, we are giving approval when you are there at the POS machine. In that period itself, I do a transaction monitoring. My rules will take care of the fraud if in case the machine is fraud prone, if there is some other problem. And I take a decision to actually either to approve a transaction or to decline the transaction. Now, this is massive. Today, on the marketing side, if you look at it, despite the fact that you may not be, I'm just giving you an example. You enter, for example, Ambience Mall, and the first shop that you enter and you go to Zara and you make a purchase. Your location is not on your phone, but you have made your first transaction, and I know that this machine is actually coming from Zara. Today, I am in a position to actually give you all offers of Ambience Mall. And I will not give you all offers. I know that Archana or XYZ buys only this kind of stuff. So there is a big data lake that is sitting over there. This data lake decides on, there's an artificial engine, artificial intelligence that is running it. There is machine learning that is actually evaluating a lot of things. And simultaneously, we are giving you almost at real-time basis. I think that's what it is. I'll tell you, never ever, and I don't know how many bankers are sitting over here or people from the finance. I'm a banker. We have built a bot, which is actually a ALM bot, asset liability management. Every day I receive almost anything between 300 to 400 crores of money. Every day that comes to me. Now, sometimes I am surplus. If I'm surplus, I need to invest immediately, and I need to invest in actually a mutual fund or some other instruments. So we build this bot, which goes to all sides, finds out what is happening and where you can get a very, where is the best overnight rate that you're getting it, and suggests it to the treasury head that this is where you need to invest. And wherever I went and I spoke to the, to people around, and these are investment bankers, people from the banking industry, no one has actually built this kind of a bot. These are some of the things that actually we have been able to achieve. And that's the reason why people feel enthused when the 70,000 crore comes over there.
Awesome. Wow. Thank God my husband is not an SBI cards and he doesn't know where I shop and how much I shop for. So let's go to...
If you use the card, we know everything about you. We just know everything, what you are doing, what is your preference, and we will give you that offers only. I don't want to cloud your, I don't want to clutter your SMS, your phone, or your email with offers which are not relevant for you. So the machine learning works over there also. Artificial intelligence works over there to give you offers also.
Excellent. We move on to Vibha's question. Vibha's asking, what's the trend in customer spends in the month of April, excluding tickets and hotel bookings vis-a-vis April 2019 and February 2020? So pre and post COVID, what are the changes in the trend of our spending?
I think every day we have almost approximately 300 to 400, I mean pre-COVID, every day, the spends would be anything about 300 to 400 crores. So people are using it across in India, abroad, POS machines, apps, e-commerce, and that's and when you are actually there is a big billion rupee sale, this goes almost to about 700 to 800 crores a day. That's the kind of spend that takes place on the cards, because we have a base of almost about 10 million cards. Today that has come down to almost about 120 to 130 crores. So every day, so there is a decline of almost about, I would say, and it's 50% to about 60%. Because people are not, the POS has come down almost significantly. Today we are doing almost, I think, about 120,000 to 150,000 transactions per day. As what we were doing, almost about 800, 900,000 per day. It has come down significantly. Travel, entertainment, everything is absolutely out. I mean, I think for next 6 months, even I would not travel. I would like to do a video conference. Then actually, if you ask me to travel to Bombay, which I was doing almost once or twice a week, today I would actually avoid traveling because it is a travel by plane. I have to go and stay in a hotel. I'd like to. So the business travel is going to come to a standstill, in my opinion. It's only if it is absolutely necessary for you to travel, you would travel. At least till about September, that's what is going to happen.
So, if we want to exclude the travel related spends, which obviously has stalled, as you said, that and also Uber, Ola, Credit card also spends give a very good insight into how is the consumer spending in general apart from travel. So if you were to see, your 300, 400 crore pre-COVID and now that's come down to 100 crore, out of that 400 crore, how much was really travel or commute related? And if you were to say, let's say 60% was travel commute and then rest of it has declined by 50%, that broadly says that that's how the consumer spend has moved, excluding the obvious ones.
No, the travel is almost about 18%. And then you have 18%. And then you have the entertainment industry, hospitality and entertainment, which again contributes almost about 15%. So this is significant. 33% is significant that goes. And this is almost come to a standstill completely. However, every year, a credit card industry works on building new opportunities for itself by creating new merchant categories. Every year you would actually build. So this year, what we are seeing today, there is a massive amount of activity that is happening on the education side. Something that was there every month, we would do approximately about 1,000 crores to about 1,200 crores on a month basis. However, that has now increased significantly, and going forward, I think that is one activity that is going to take place and continue. Utility again is becoming a very big. It was already a big category, but now people, everybody sitting at home wants to pay. And you have only, you have to pay digitally most of the time. So either you're going to use a credit card, you're going to use a prepaid instrument, you're going to use an e-payment, a wallet. An e-wallet has made a major comeback. After the UPI, e-wallet actually was supposed to die on its own. However, you see that the e-wallets have made a massive comeback. In fact, actually, we have relaxed our norms because of the fraud that would take place on the e-wallets. We had stopped loading it from 10 o'clock in the night till 6 o'clock in the morning. We have reopened it right now because there are a lot of people who are loading their wallets through the credit card. So I think overall, if you look at it, obviously there is going to be a major change in which the merchant categories are going to evolve. And you will have to look at those kind of things, how you stay relevant and what is the opportunity. Massive opportunities, I'm sure, will come up in India. And if there is a rebound, just a question whether it's going to be a V rebound, it's going to be a U rebound, or it's going to be a L rebound. I mean, we feel that it should be a V rebound because of the overall factors that are emanating. However, if it is a U rebound, it's going to be a little bit of a problem in terms of taking time to come back to the new norm.
So lots of questions here. Let's quickly move through the questions. Rakesh ji is asking, I mean, you've answered it partially, but do you believe post-corona your products and business models will change?
I think we are already looking at it October. We had started issuing the e-card, which is a card. I can send you a message if you have an Android, because iOS is not open. iOS as such is only 8% in India. We were sending from October onwards the e-card on your phone, which you could activate it. You could generate a PIN, which is a green PIN, electronic PIN you could generate. And this card that we were sending it on the phone was actually a full-fledged card, which would mean that it could do a POS transaction, which is a tap and go. Without the swipe, you can have the tap and go. It was actually capable of doing an electronic transaction on the e-commerce site. What we have done is now, I mean, right now we are, there's hardly anything, only 1,000 cards we are issuing every day. But now we are going to give it every card, we are going to give it an electronic card. Any renewal that is going to come will actually be sent to you in an electronic format. Every new issuance is going to be there, every lost card. So what will happen is that in a second, you have a message from us in your phone, and if you have an Android phone, you can very easily download it and start transacting straight away. So I think that's going to be a new norm. The sourcing is going to change. The collection is going to change. So there's going to be a massive, we are already building, we are perfecting our models. in terms of, I remain busy more to ensure that we have a much more digital journey that we can offer it to the consumer, and we offer it is seamless, it is frictionless, and when you actually experience it, you are in a position to say that, wow, this is the word, this is the way forward for anyone.
So Mr. Goyal is asking you, what percentage of your credit card payments you still get through checks?
Very limited. It is 0.02%. It's hardly anything.
And Mr. Rakesh Khanna is asking, what's the digital percentage in developed economies?
Actually depends. China would be very big. I mean, when you look at the digital push, US is legacy. US is just this time when I went after almost about 3-4 years, to the first time I saw that they have now those swanky kind of POS machines. Otherwise, they always had that legacy kind of old machine. Australia is pretty good in terms of the digital penetration. That's one market we have studied. Obviously, and Singapore is okay. I mean, I would not say that they are very good. But I think we are doing pretty well. Only China is what I would look at it in terms of the digital competition where we would like to be.
So, Mr. Vishnu Prakash has a question for you. Thank you for waiting, Vishnuji. Please ask.
No, we can't hear you, sir.
Okay. I'll go to the next question meanwhile. Anurag is asking a follow-up
Anuradha
question.
Anuradha, I think, I'm asking. Oh. She's raising her hand. Anuradha.
No. I wasn't.
Okay.
Sorry, I must have pressed something.
So, Anurag is asking a follow-up question on AI. Who's managing the AI?
We are doing it in-house completely. All the robots, we're using partners. We have for AI, we are using NICE Technologies, which is actually an Israeli-based company. They are also helping us build our the RPA platforms. We are using, I think, Senseforth or some company for our human. We are building humanoids. I think we would have actually introduced one of the humanoids, which could do a full self customer. Especially, we have almost about 50-60 centers where we do a lot of customer servicing. So we had built a prototype, which was very pretty good, a humanoid where you could do a complete self-servicing on the terminal itself. We were thinking of installing it in all malls where you could go and do whatever it is possible, a small printer attached to it on the servicing side. So I think these are the two companies which are working very closely in terms of the new tech. We are also working on voice biometrics. I think what we are looking at is voice biometric and there are a lot of other things that are going. I think IVR is going to be a complete whole technology. You will not go through an IVR now. We are going to recognize your voice and we are going to divert you directly to an operator or directly where you can. We have a chatbot which is 97.9% right every time. I think that is again running on our artificial intelligence. That is what we do. I think those are some of the initiatives that we have taken with some of the partners, but all intellectual, if it's owned by us, the code, all the source codes are kept in the digital vaults that we maintain. So I think we believe that it is very, very important for us to have a control over the AI and the RPA and the machine learning that exists in the company.
Am I audible now?
Yes,
yeah. Vishnuji, please, your question.
Thank you very
Ashna,
much.
Ashna, I also have something later.
Definitely.
All right. Mr. Prasad, thanks. I have a couple of questions. One, with this increase in the digital transactions, cards, and so on, there is also increase in the credit card frauds and interceptions, mimicking, and things. So, are there any suggestions that you have or anything 1, 2, 3, 4 that credit card users should do and not do? And secondly and lastly, overall, what is the percentage of defaults in credit card payments? Is it in keeping with the global norms? Is it less, more in India? How does it work?
Okay, one is obviously there's a digital, massive digital push. And it obviously, you know, you have people who become smart very quickly, especially the fraudsters. They're very, very smart in terms of finding out any loophole into the system or to make out that what can be done into actually hoodwink a consumer. So one is that we do massive amount of education to ask people, and most of the frauds that take place is because you have shared your OTP. Now, sharing an OTP is something that you should not have done it. It's like giving a key of the vault to somebody and asking him to go ahead and do whatever you want to do. If you have yourself given the key to the vault, there is nothing that can be done.
Right.
I mean, as a banker, I can tell you, a branch, an accountant and a head cashier, they hold the key. Now, a vault can have those hundreds of crores, thousands of crores of rupees inside the vault. Now, you have given keys to two persons. Now, they can do whatever they want with that key. I mean, if they want, they can take out, and once in a while, every quarter, you're going to have an audit, and then you find out that what is happening inside the vault. However, you have to have a lot of cross checks and balances built into it. So one is to ensure that never, ever is the world. Never, ever will you share your OTP with anybody, come what may. In terms of the cloning that is happening, in terms of the mirroring, the software mirroring that is taking place, I think one has to be very, very careful. You under no circumstances you should actually give anything to anyone. I think that is one of the most important things. And I think in the new norm, I would suggest that one should keep the credit card number properly with himself, not share it. The CVV is important not to be shared. And there is all customer privacy and the other instructions that are there that is completely shared and pushed, and then information given to the consumers. I think that needs to be understood. I think the financial literacy is going to play a major role in the new environment. It's not just the credit card. Actually, the frauds take place everywhere. I can just tell you that actually we have Visa says, and Visa felicitated us in Beijing. It was last October that they called us. And in Southeast Asia, our fraud numbers are the least. And I gave you the numbers of 1.4 million transactions every day. You can imagine the kind of transaction. We have the least. This year, yesterday only, I was reviewing it with the risk team. The net loss, the total fraud is about 3.5 crores. I think it is about 3.95 crores. The recovery office has been almost about 3.9 crores, and we have lost almost about 50 lakhs only. So I think the frauds will take place. We have to be careful. There has to be more education that needs to be told. People have to be more careful and need to understand that what it is. In terms of the defaults that you are talking, in India, the defaults are pretty well managed now. We are not living in a world which was 2007 and 9. Where you had very little information about the consumer. You did not have a mature credit bureau. You did not have many other, you know, the data that sits with us. I mentioned to you, I have 2 to 3 petabytes of data. So today, when I actually do an analysis of you, when I score you, there is multiple information that I'm actually collecting from you. One is I actually pick up your score from the credit bureau. And the credit bureaus today are as matured as any of the market. And I have worked across. I worked in US for a very long time. The credit bureaus in India are very matured. And they are fairly good. If you have taken loan, I have information for 10 years for you. Like if you have 10 years back, you picked up a loan, I will have every information. But the credit score is actually at any given point of time. It doesn't give me much information other than that you have a score of 700, you have a score of 800. So what we also look at is what is called a trending data. I look at your 36-month history and I say that actually how many trades that you have, trade means how many products that you have taken, loans that you have taken. Were you defaulting? Did you default? Did you delay? Whom were you delaying to? Were you delaying it to me? You're delaying it to others. You're paying it to others and not paying to me. All those things are put into the risk model that you do. Then you have your own data from which you will pull information to see. And then there is identity and application scores that comes in. So today you have such robust system sitting in place for any of the credit, and every credit card issuer today, 90% of the credit card issuers are very, very responsible today. Nobody is over leveraging. If you are good for say 100,000 and I give you 200,000, actually I am taking that risk of over leveraging you.
Sure.
Today, nobody is over leveraging. And therefore the defaults that are there in the credit card industry today are any in the range of 2 to 2.5%. And please remember that this is an unsecured loan, completely unsecured. There is no security sitting over there, but the credit culture that you see in India today, it is phenomenal. Everybody is so careful to ensure that his credit score is pretty well and pretty good. People actually who lose their job, they are the people who actually are able to default, unless you came with an intention of not repaying it at all. So the willingness to pay or the ability to repay or willingness not to repay is something that you will always look at it and factor it in your model. However, there are a large number of people who come back and say, okay, please take this money from me, because they are very, very, very much interested in maintaining their credit score. I think those are some of the things that are there. So today, I think we are in a, it's a different world completely.
Thank you.
Mr. Sharma, you please ask your question and then I'll move. I also had to ask about the credit cards now, but we'll wait for Mr. Sharma to ask his question first.
Yeah, Mr. Prasad, I'm asking a more of a macro issue that is about the financial markets. I'm sure since you've done the IPO, you must be tracking the market. As we know, that capital market is quite nervous these days. One day it goes up, next day it goes down. And I have another board who are, DRHP has been approved. They are worried whether to access the market, not to access the market. What is the mood of the capital market? How do you assess? And how it is likely to fare in times to come? We have seen a huge fall, then market has recovered, then one day going down, one day going up. What does it indicate?
So it's very difficult to actually predict the market. It's very cagey right now. It's very uncertain world that we are living in. We do not know the extent. You can only factor in. Last week, Fitch actually said that the India rating is, India is going to grow at 1.9. Today, they are saying that it is growing to at 0.8 GDP. So it's very difficult to predict what is going to happen tomorrow. It's more of sentiments that are going to prevail today. In these kind of emergent or very extraordinary circumstances, it is going to be extraordinary responses that are going to come. That is going to be there definitely. So I would, actually within the country, if you move around, if you go to Rajkot, which is the second largest center after Bombay, you are going to hear a completely different story. You go to Bombay, it's a different story. You go to Jaipur, Ahmedabad, and Delhi is actually, I think, about fifth or sixth in terms of the way it with invest in the on the bourses. So I would, I'm not competent also to say that how it is going to be, but it would depend significantly on the disposable income, on actually how the economy is going to behave, how the demand is going to come up, because I think those are some of the questions that have to be answered first, and we have to see how it progresses to come out with whether actually the stock market is going to behave in a very orderly fashion or it is not going to behave. So I think there is no one particular answer to say that the stock market can behave like this only. We have to wait and watch and see, keep our fingers crossed and believe on what is happening around the globe. And today, the Indian economy is so globalized. I mean, it is absolutely attached to the world. Anything happening anywhere in the world is going to affect the bourses straight up. And you see, in the night, we look at the Dow Jones. I'm sure that you would also be looking at the oil. Throughout the night, I keep on getting the messages about the Dow Jones. I get it from Hong Kong. And in the morning when I up, I see the China numbers also. And the moment you have seen these numbers, the market behaves exactly like this. There is no reason. I mean, if the market is falling in US, Hong Kong or China, if India also falls over there, there's something that is, so it is, I think, more sentiments than anything else.
Yeah, that's true. But it all depends when the stability comes.
It's the extent and the gravity of COVID. social distancing, how long the social distancing is going to continue. All those things will decide on what is going to happen.
So I'm going to ask you one question and then we'll move on to, over to the other questions. SBI Cards is the second largest credit card issuer of our country after HDFC, and SBI Cards has an 18% share. So how has the credit cards market evolved in the last 2 years, and how are the numbers growing? And I mean, I know you're touching tier 2, tier 3 cities. So just a short journey.
Actually, one is the credit card industry's growth in India, and the second is the credit card growth of SBI credit cards. Obviously, in the last 36 months, if you look at it, and these are industry reports, I don't give any numbers which are purely based on, I don't want to color it also. Becoming a number one player for us is not difficult. With 440 million customer base of SBI, you remove the Jandhan accounts and everything, you will have still have 200 million accounts, which I think I can look at it. I've already looked at almost about 70-80 million account. I still have to look at about 130 million account. Becoming a number one is not a problem. It's not a question of becoming a number one and ensuring whether you are actually reaching over there as a number one, number two. I think more important thing is whether you are going to be a profitable company, whether you're going to be a valuable company or not. I think that's what decides on what is going to be the growth trajectory. We, in the last 36 months, and this is our industry number, we have been the number one player across 36 months, 24 months, 12 months, 1 month. We have been the highest. Every month we do approximately 300,000 cards every month. And this is about 50,000 to 100,000 cards more than any of the card players. So I think that is not a problem for us. The penetration of credit card in India is just 3 cards. For a population of 100, which is 3%. In US, actually in Singapore, it is 11, where we feel that India should move. You go to US, it is almost about 280 cards for a population, about 2.8 cards per a wallet. In India, it is 0.03. So I think there is massive scope for growth in credit card. Credit card industry will evolve. Credit card industry has already evolved. It will continue to evolve. So these are some of the things that will continue to, propel it. For example, the e-card. The card on the phone was never there. Today, you don't need a physical. I think in 2 years' time, you will have to ask us to give you a plastic. I will not give you a plastic or a metal. I'll say that, okay, here is a card. Here is the electronic card. If you want a physical card, probably I will say I'm going to charge you $1,000. If you want a metal card, I'm going to charge you 5,000 rupees. You live with a digital card. So I think that's the way it will evolve and find its own space in terms of the biggest advantage of a credit card vis-a-vis any other is actually the process of authentication and the reconciliation. Today, I mean, you have UPIs, you have prepaid, you have everything is there. But the authentication of a transaction, I think by the time you swipe a card on a POS machine and put it back in a wallet, you have an SMS from us, the transaction has been approved. If you are actually disputing a transaction, that is again thing that how quick and how fast and efficient is the system. I think those are some of the things that drive the credit card industry, and it becomes a much more enhanced product than any other product.
So I think I'm going to take over from here. Thank you for all the questions, and I apologize that I won't be able to ask more questions because of shortage of time, but we've had an extremely interesting session with Mr. Prasad. I want to ask you one question, the last one. I want you to give some guidance, a piece of advice to the youngsters of WorldSpa, to everybody who's watching right now.
Oh, I think all of us are young.
Youngsters starting their journey. Of course, we are all young.
I really don't know what to say. There's a lot of things. I don't want to be, theoretical kind of thing. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that one needs to do. One has to be actually, I think hard work is very, very important. You need to read a lot. You need to internalize. You need to fall back on. You have to introspect continuously. And you have to see how things are panning out. So I think there is a lot of things that one needs to know. But there is no substitute for a hard work. I think that's more important. you continue to do hard work, if you continue to work hard, work smart, I think those are some of the things that is going to help them in their journey. Intellectual honesty is very important. Whatever you want to do, you can be firm, polite, you have to be very, very honest in your dealings. And I'm not talking about, you know, the regular honesty kind of stuff. I'm talking about intellectual honesty in the way you conduct yourself, into the fairness that you have when you're dealing with people. That, I think those are some of the things that are very important in terms of doing it.
And your mantra for happiness, the last piece.
Mantra for happiness. I don't know. You need to do things your own way. You need to actually, I don't know what makes me happy. I think work makes me happy. So I think...
Great, that's an excellent thing.
I was not really...
You've worked hard, you've been sincere, you've taken the SBI cards to new heights, and you're successful. What else? Of course,
that's you will great. Try to run faster than others.
Well, we are all hoping for more success.
If you have somebody like Usain Bolt with you, you still have to run faster than him.
So we are wishing you all the best. And we thank you for coming in today.